What is going on? It is the MMA Podcast 145. Thank you so much for tuning in November 6th, 2015. We got a lot to talk about. It was a boring October, but we got an exciting first week of November to break down, a couple cards to break down. We hope you had a happy Halloween this Saturday. After a relatively boring weekend for mixed martial arts, we got a big Bellator card, Bellator 145. A big Brooks vs. Pitbull match. They had a scuffle before the fight. And, of course, UFC is putting on a card in Brazil, headlined by the trilogy fight between Vitor Belfort and Dan Henderson. Going to break that one down, too. Let's do it. We did it, mama. We did it for the love of the game.
You're listening to the MMA Podcast!
That's right, Lenny Hart. Thank you so much for tuning in. Follow us on Twitter, as always, at the MMA Podcast. TheMMAPodcast.com, which goes back and forth between being updated daily and updated monthly. Apologies for that. If you want up-to-date news about when we're going live, we always tweet a live link at the top of the show. Tweet links when we post it on iTunes, SoundCloud, and YouTube. You can visit us on Twitter at the MMA Podcast. We'll save shout-outs for the end. Been doing that recently. No plugs other than to Filthy FRB Show, check that out. A recent episode with X-Pac was super good. And of course, our co-host on the line, follow him as well on Twitter at Sweet Pappy Jones. It's P Money. What's going on, brother?
Yes, indeed, Jake. It's your boy P Money in the house. A lovely evening to all the MMA podcast followers out there. Always a pleasure doing business with you guys. It's going lovely out here. We're finally having a break in the weather. Winter is here. We've fallen back, so to speak, for those of us in daylight savings observing states or countries. And it's going lovely here. I'm really enjoying this winter weather. I'm amped up for this big UFC season to start off as well.
Big UFC season. I think the last few months we've only had about two cards a month, which is a definite slowdown in what has been a pretty hectic 2014 and 2015 for the UFC. This month, they're cranking it back up. We have a card every single weekend in October, the 7th, the 14th, the 21st, and 28th. Then the first weekend of December, we're off, but then that second weekend is going to be maybe the biggest weekend of the entire year. We have three cards back to back to back. We have the Page and Sage card on Thursday. We have the Tough card headlined by, I believe that was supposed to be Nurmagomedov, but he got injured, but it's still going to be that big Tough finale card. And then, of course, UFC 194 headlined by maybe the two most anticipated title fights on the line right now. I'm scanning through all of them in my head. Aldo McGregor, Weidman Rockhold. Both of those are fights that should be pretty closely contested, and two pretty big belts there in the featherweight and middleweight belts. So strap in, because it's about to be a crazy 6 weeks in mixed martial arts. And if you are religious, even if you aren't, just let's all take a moment of silence and pray to whatever deity exists in the sky, if there is one, that, oh my God, the injury bug the last couple years. You know, I get that people get injured, especially with the nature of this sport, training for fights. There are a lot of times where things have happened. It just seems like there has just been a kooky, insane amount of late pullouts to big fights recently. Title fights, we were supposed to see Conor Aldo The jewel of the next 6 weeks we were supposed to see in July. Aldo pulls out late. Instead, we get Mendez, who, you know, trains with very little time and gets defeated. Just let's take a couple seconds and pray to whatever deity exists that we get some good MMA fights. All right. Yeah. Let's get straight to it. I don't think I have anything else other than if you are listening live on Ustream, you can, as always, call in. The phone number is 213-457-3380, or you can Skype us at the MMA Podcast. And coincidentally, apparently if you call, or apparently if you Skype us, maybe if you call too, I'm not sure. Try it out if you fucking want. If you're not listening live, if you're listening on, say, iTunes, YouTube, SoundCloud, we have been able to get voicemails in the past. So if you want to call us and leave us a super abusive message, or just some stupid inane shit that you feel like we should play on next week's episode, leave me a voicemail and I'll probably play it on next week's episode, unless you specifically ask me not to. We had our boy Kevin Black at Technics 88 Scottish Fedor, who used to always leave us epic voicemails. So if you're him, if you're someone else, if you just want to leave us a legit salient point about, you know, the week of news in MMA, and you think, you know, X, Y, and Z about so-and-so fighter, call in and say it, and we'll play it. Definitely feel free to try to call those numbers, 213-457-3380, or the MMA Podcast on Skype, because I usually am not logged in on Skype, and it's not going to bother me. You'll just ring a logged-off Skype, and I'll see it the next time I come on. Or, of course, tweet us, the MMA Podcast, if you don't feel like talking. We did not have any MMA this past weekend, so I guess we'll dive straight into the news. Probably the biggest bit of news, sadly. I mean, it was the only real MMA news I saw being covered by all the casual news outlets. Were Conor McGregor, Gunnar Nelson, and apparently this actor who's on Game of Thrones and plays a character called the Mountain. Conor is like, what, 5'9", you know, fights at 145. This dude is like 6'9", 380, sparring with Conor. I saw a lot of, this is just good pub to start pumping up his next fight. I thought it might be kind of stupid, you know? I mean, you've got a guy who's 6'9", who's, yeah, he's obviously not throwing hard punches, or else he would literally murder Conor, but, there were moments where, you know, this giant dude is kind of trying to grab Conor and, you know, twerk him around a little bit, spin him and move him. And, man, you really don't want to fuck up a knee or an ankle or, you know, anything, a shoulder. And I don't know if sparring with a guy who weighs over 200 pounds more than you is necessarily a good idea. I don't want to sound like, you know, old grandpa Jake here, but I kind of was thinking the entire time watching this, God, Conor, don't be stupid. What the fuck? What did you think, Pat?
We got old man Walters on the podcast tonight. How old man Walters sitting on his stoop.
Yeah, you know what? God.
Quit your MMA demos out there, these kids in their roughhousing. You know, I think this was some finely crafted PR. It did not appear to me to be anything more than like a demo, really. The Mountain, maybe he was trying to physically impose his will. Maybe he was trying to pull some wall install on Conor McGregor. And yeah, as you mentioned, you can you could definitely blow a knee out or rupture something trying to, you know, just planning your body weight wrong or something like that. Any number of things could happen for sure. But I think this was just some play fighting right here. I really don't think that they were doing any kind of serious sparring or anything. I mean, this mountain guy, as you mentioned, he's an actor apparently on Game of Thrones, and to the best of my knowledge, has zero mixed martial arts credentials or martial arts training to begin with. So it really just doesn't make sense for him to be sparring in there. It was really just a photo op, and it's some McGregor crack out there for all the big McGregor fans or whatever it may be. I mean, I like the guy, but geez, this is just crazy. Since he's came on the scene, it's like there has to be one or two headlines with him every week on every single major MMA media outlet. And well, here we are. This is one of the first things we're covering on the show. So kind of sad it's been that slow in the MMA world lately. Yeah, like I said, can't wait for it to pick back up. But yeah, I think this was just some PR for a slow MMA news week.
Yeah, I might not agree with everything you said, but I do agree a lot with the end of that, which is it's kind of stupid PR, but, you know, as long as they're talking about MMA in the mainstream, I think that's a good thing, I guess. Speaking about MMA and mainstream PR, sort of the face of the mainstream MMA PR machine has been Ronda Rousey. Not been a good few weeks for Ronda Rousey. I'm sorry, but this snowball all sort of started with the Travis Brown thing, which, yeah, it's been rumored for a while. Travis Brown obviously has that dark cloud over him of being alleged by his, I don't know if they're still married, his either wife or ex-wife, that he abused her, and then a UFC private investigator looked into it and found Brown innocent, but everyone sort of questioned the bias there. Sort of like, you know, the recent Roger Goodell NFL thing where, yeah, the NFL hired an investigator who decided that the NFL was not in, you know, was not in the wrong in investigating Brady. Well, yeah, of course, and a federal court ended up throwing that out. But yeah, this Travis Brown thing happens where he goes on some show and says, I think the quote was, "I'm her man and she's my woman." And Rousey blocks everyone who tweets her about it. Starts off a little rocky, and then news where Ronda's mom, who, you know, her mom since pretty much day one has been an outspoken supporter of Rousey, is always, you know, front row, very visible at all of her fights. Recently did an ad with her for UFC 193. So Rousey's mom, who she's very close with, says some very negative things about her head trainer, Edmund Tarverdian, going as far as to say, "I would run him over with my car if it wasn't against the law." Now just more bad PR for Ronda Rousey. She goes on some jaunt about how she doesn't want to be a role model, which, yeah, sure, whatever, but if you don't want to be a role model, then don't let the UFC roll you around as a role model the last 3 years and go on Good Morning America and say Kim Kardashian's a bad role model. Like it or not, you are, and just saying that you're not isn't an excuse to not act like one. Then this random news, I mean, this is the least noteworthy of all, but maybe the funniest, because I was seeing a lot of tweets about Lubegate. This morning, apparently, Rousey was under more media criticism for comments in some magazine that's probably not even worth mentioning, maybe like Rolling Stone, I don't know. But she says that people who use lube are lazy, and lube is only needed when you're not spending enough time to arouse your partner. And there, I googled Ronda Rousey lube, and I didn't get what I wanted, but the first article was some, I forget who she was writing for, saying, well, not everyone needs or can get wet, and we need lube. And it was a really, I mean, definitely the least noteworthy of all, but just the most, maybe the most ridiculous. If we do awards again this year and we do the most ridiculous headline of 2015, this will probably be one of them. Everyone on Twitter talking about lube this morning. But to get back to seriousness, probably the biggest of all of this, more than the Travis Brown thing, more than her mom talking negatively about her head trainer and her team, the Glendale Fighting Club, they're going into bankruptcy, a trustee pursuing GFC for liquidation, Tarverdian filing taxes, saying that he hadn't filed the last several years, and they're claiming basically nothing in assets and high six figure debt. Just, you know, crazy shit. And the point I'm getting to here is Ronda Rousey has a fucking fight in what, it's the sixth now? So in 8 days, Ronda Rousey has a fight. Do you think, I mean, you know, she has seemed through her career like one of the most, you know, resolute, mentally strong fighters out there. You know, she's the biggest women's champion ever in the sport, you know, easily the biggest female star the sport's ever seen. And she's getting into the category of the biggest star, period, that the sport's ever seen. She's never lost a fight, but I can't remember there being so much stuff going, you know, so much of a whirlwind going on around her leading up to a fight. Are you thinking, like I am, that this might negatively impact her focus and performance coming up at UFC 193?
It's certainly got me questioning her ability to focus and to stay on track for her upcoming performance, because this certainly does seem to be the most, at least well-publicized amount of adversity that she's had to deal with since she burst onto the scene, even in Strikeforce. I really don't recall too much personal drama or anything like that, and perhaps it was just a fact that she wasn't as big a star back then as she is now, but I certainly don't recall this whirlwind of media activity. And as you mentioned as well, she really is the biggest star in the UFC. She's the biggest women's mixed martial artist since Gina Carano. Gina Carano was almost as big a crossover star. I mean, Gina Carano had movie roles herself and fairly critically acclaimed movies, if I recall. And so she's reached a level, but she's gone far beyond that. Ronda Rousey is definitely the biggest star the UFC has probably ever had. She is the biggest crossover, and it is Ronda Rousey's fault, as you mentioned, for letting herself be marketed as a role model, as you know, as someone that would be willing to do all the media and stuff like that. She put herself out there. I mean, of course, the UFC can market her any way that she want or that they want.
Yeah.
But she volunteered her services to go out and to be active and to be a spokesperson for these campaigns and things like that. So
don't write a book called Your Fight, My Fight, and then say, no, I'm not a role model. Like, the book's called Your Fight, My Fight. Like, you're literally, like, it may as well be called, hey, let me be your role model. Like, come on.
Yeah, I'm your mentor. I'm an advocate, yeah, to
I'm like people. You. I want to help you. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So you can't start backpedaling like that. That's what happened with Jon Jones. Jon Jones, his first couple years in the UFC, man, I love Jon Jones, but he was that dude. He was putting on that front. When in reality, Jon Jones, you know, he might like to keep it a little grimy. And you know what? There's nothing wrong with that. I respect you more, Jon Jones. Just come out and say it. You know what? We like to get down where we from. That's all right. As long as you're true to yourself, that's the number one thing. Ronda Rousey, if you want to come out and say, hey, you know what? I'm just a badass. You know, I went through some hard things and I overcame in my life, but I'm not going to do media. I'm not going to do this and that besides, you know, pull a Nick Diaz. You do
embrace being a heel.
Embrace the heel, you know, and it's not even the heel. It's just, hey, I don't like talking to cameras. That's really the main thing. I don't like talking to cameras. I don't like talking to people, you know, but I overcame. So can you. Let's just, you know, leave it at that. Keep it simple. And hey, you know what? Focus on you and overcome in the way you need to overcome. But yeah, this certainly is the most tumultuous period that's been advertised anyhow in her career. And she's got a world champion that she's going up against in Holly Holm, who is also undefeated in women's mixed martial arts. So even though she hasn't looked as impressive, who knows? She could very well be peaking right now. She's over there at Jackson Winklejohn. This is going to be her third fight in the UFC. Perhaps she's finally going to be able to work off some of those nerves or something like that. Maybe the spotlight will set her back or make her regress. But there's a possibility we could see the best Holly Holm that we've seen coming into this, while at the same time we're seeing a Ronda Rousey that has the most adversity that she's had to deal with since she came onto the women's mixed martial arts scene. So we very well could be seeing Ronda Rousey in a compromised state, if you will. Whether or not that will be enough for Holly Holm to get the victory that night, just Ronda Rousey being off her game mentally, theoretically, or hypothetically, there does seem to be there's a disposition there, but I don't know that it'll be enough. It certainly helps Holly Holm, though.
I think Ronda Rousey, overall as an MMA fighter, is better than Holm. And I think if they fight 10 times, Rousey wins either 8 or 9 times out of the 10. But it just seems like the stars might be aligning just so Holm training with the best camp in the sport at Jackson's. Rousey, big question marks as far as her personal life goes, from her mom to her new boyfriend to her coach to her team to backpedaling, saying that she doesn't want to be a role model now, but she's not really, you know, she's kind of still trying to be that face and be that voice of MMA. You know who one of the most popular fighters, and I'm not talking about Chael Sonnen, but you know who of recent memory has done a perfect job at embracing the heel role?
Ooh, I'm trying to, besides Chael Sonnen, oh, maybe Rashad Evans?
Rashad Evans, good, but I'm not thinking
later
MMA.
Later in his career, anyways.
I'm not thinking MMA. I'm thinking boxing.
Okay. Oh, Money Mayweather?
Floyd Mayweather Jr. has done a perfect job at building himself up as a dastardly piece of shit heel. And he says shit all the time. He says shit all the time that he knows is just gonna stir up people who don't like him. Like he's on HBO 24/7 hitting the bags with a giant stack of $100 bills in each hand. And he's doing shit and saying shit that is just so extraordinarily cocky. And he's a smart guy. Floyd knows that the reason that, you know, he made, I believe, close to half a billion dollars fighting Manny Pacquiao. Did most people tune in because they're big Manny fans and they've followed him his whole career and they want to see Manny win? Not really. Do they tune in because they're boxing aficionados and want to see the sweet science? Not really. The reason why Floyd sells so many pay-per-views is people tune in because they want to see him lose. Everyone, almost everyone who watches that fight is tuning into the fight because they want to see Floyd lose, because he has this background of hitting women and he's the most hated person in sports. It is very acceptable to go on a mainstream network, ESPN, Fox, CBS, and just start openly talking about how much of a piece of shit Floyd is, and, you know, he's not a good person. person, and he does this. He's brash and arrogant, and he's shown no remorse for his past. And it's like they don't get it. They don't realize that when you're going on ESPN, you know, ESPN2 outside the lines, and you're like, yeah, I followed Floyd, and he's horrible, blah, blah, blah. You're just making him more money. You're just getting more people who are interested in the fight and are going to buy the fight and are going to end up putting more money in his pocket. And Floyd has done the best job selling himself and selling his brand. And I mean, he's a smart dude. He gets half the proceeds because he owns his own boxing promotion. I mean, you know, TMT is a real thing. Like, he's been a very shrewd businessman, and I think played his card perfectly. And I think, you know, Jones hasn't realized that, or he just doesn't want to do it. But he's at times had little moments of brilliance. Like, he made an Instagram video where he was mocking all the fans, saying that he poked eyes. And recently he had a pretty heel line against Cormier, saying he wanted to whoop his ass on the OSU mats, the college where Daniel went and wrestled at in the Big 12. But I don't know. No one could just sell that heel roll like fucking Floyd. He is a master of it.
Yeah, he really is, and it's just about embracing who you are. Actually, as you were talking there about Floyd embracing that heel roll, it really
your quality is super shaky. I don't know. You sounded good before. You sound better now, doing? I think. Yeah, a lot okay. better.
Right, you know, we've been having some bandwidth issues as of late. I apologize for that. But as you were mentioning Floyd Mayweather, frogs at the hornet's nest, if you will, I was thinking, do you think he came out with the whole him being illiterate just to make all the elitist intellectuals hate him? I mean, could that have been something just to stir the pot there?
I don't know. There's a possibility.
I'm kind of trolling right there, of course.
Yeah, I mean, listening to that clip where it came out that he really was sort of struggling reading a thing. Which, by the way, it's funny you bring that up, because I don't think I ever talked about it on this podcast. Since when is it cool to make fun of adults for being illiterate because they grew up super poor? Like, I get it is sort of funny that the guy is a near billionaire and is so arrogant and brash and talks so much shit. And when he can't read something, it must be a very humbling experience. But I'm not getting on you, but I'm getting on really everyone. Since when is it fucking cool to, like, make fun of someone for not being able to read? Like, that's kind of a really dick move.
Yeah, no, that's pretty messed up as far as making fun of somebody with any handicap, really. And I mean, the ultimate irony is to the people that want to make fun of him. I mean, I guarantee he's shitting on you, and you being the universal you, whoever would want to make fun of someone for being illiterate. In the case of Floyd Money Mayweather, I mean, they call the man Floyd Money Mayweather, just like they call me P Money. But I'll tell you what, hats off to Floyd Mayweather. He's shitting on my income. That's for damn sure. And guaranteed, he's shitting on 99.9% of the people on this planet. And so
he's
made
more money than any athlete ever.
I'm astounded by that, and I hope he holds on to that money because he's dropping those $1 million bets like crazy. I hope he hits on those, but yeah, I mean, hey, God bless him. You can't knock the dude if you're making fun of an illiterate dude. Well, hey, that dude can't read right, but he's got more money than you ever will in your life. So who should really be making fun of who here?
you offer me a deal where I get half $1 billion, and in exchange, I'm a little dyslexic. You know I'm taking that deal every damn day. Come on, son. Let's move on from talking about Ronda. Actually, really quick, I wanted to play this 45-second video. It was a very good breakdown. If you haven't seen his videos yet, Robin Black, he's been on the JRE, and now the UFC has hired him to do official breakdowns of fights, which is awesome. We're sort of seeing more and more of these really good MMA analysts with sharp eyes. And this is a really quick clip of Robin Black breaking down Rousey Holm. If you haven't seen Black's videos before, Google him. Robin Black, spelled just like it sounds. This is his quick breakdown of a fight we'll be breaking down on next week's episode, the main event of UFC 193, Ronda Rousey and Holly Holm.
Robin Black, and this is the breakdown. Ronda Rousey, the champ, the greatest of all time, faces her toughest challenger, former boxing world champion Holly Holm. What's the fight about? Well, when you fight Ronda, it's about range. Holm's going to do well out here, but if she pushes on inside of Ronda's hot zone, Ronda will take you apart. She'll grab you chest to chest. You'll go for a ride. Bam! Just like that. But on the outside, Holly Holm's boxing. She leverages it to get out to distance, and at distance, she has KO'd 5 women with kicks. 5. Can she do it to Ronda? Can she shock the world? If Holly Holm controls the range...
And there were a few seconds left there, but it froze up. He, I think, said if she controls the range, it might be her fight. Very interesting. If you hadn't had to set the line right now for Holm, what would it be? Because currently she's at like plus 1,200. I'm betting those odds. Do I think that Rousey will probably win? Yes. Like I said, she's the better fighter. But saying that Holm is 12-1, I think it's a little closer than that. I think it's more like 6-1, 7-1. Rousey, you know, she's been dominant, but I think there is a decent chance that Holm is going to be her toughest fight to date.
Yeah, I mean, she certainly has all the skills. Holly Holm, she's got that Joanna Jędrzejczyk, at least the multi-time world champion credentials. She was one of the most pound-for-pound women champion boxing women's boxing champions out there. I mean, she had world championships in multiple weight classes as a women's boxer. So she's got the hand skills. She's undefeated in MMA. I think she's looking a lot better than Betch Kohea. She certainly deserves to have much better odds of what she's getting right now. I think I'd agree with you. Maybe about plus 6, and she certainly has the capability to be Ronda Rousey's toughest fight. I mean, just like Kat Zingano did, but it's all about the game plan. Is she going to come out there and run at Ronda Rousey with a flying knee, which is, I'm sorry, I don't ever want to perpetuate the thought of fixed fights in mixed martial arts. I really hope that is not a prevalent thing or anything that actively happens, but my God, that was either the stupidest game plan anybody's ever come up with, or that fight was fixed. Like, those are really the only two options. As long as Holly Holm doesn't run at her with some stupid bullshit like Kat Zingano did, she and actually tries in this fucking fight, she has a good chance here. She can put some hands on somebody. I don't think we've really got to see it in MMA before, and hopefully she can let that go and put it on Ronda Rousey, because it'd just be great to see somebody give Ronda an actual fight. She certainly has the potential, and that's the other thing as well. She's with Greg Jackson, with Greg Jackson's camp. They've always been known for putting together solid game plans for opponents. So she's got the right coach there. I definitely would rather have Greg Jackson in my corner than Edmund Tarverdian. So she's got some things going for her. This is an interesting fight. And yeah, definitely. Plus 1,200 is way off. I'd have it about plus 6 today. Plus 600.
Yeah, and speaking of Rousey, that's actually a good segue. Speaking of giving her a close fight, the only woman to take her outside the first round, Miesha Tate. Misha Tate getting no love from the UFC. Yet another story about the UFC kind of shafting fighters. Misha Tate really talking about how upset she was about not getting that Ronda Rousey fight. Saying, quote, on the MMA Hour, "The whole reason I do this sport is because I love it. When politics get in the way and they start messing shit up, excuse my language, I'm just not going to stand for it. It's not why I got into fighting. It's not why I do what I do. And I'm not going to go out there and put on a crap performance in front of all my fans because I didn't feel right about it." And then she talked about when she found out Holm got the fight in front of her. Quote, "To wake up to that, it was almost like waking up to still being in a nightmare. I felt like I wasn't even sure if it was quite awake yet. Like, am I still sleeping? What is going on right now? I'm half dazed and I'm trying to take it all in. And I just felt extremely overwhelmed. I just got really depressed. Honestly, I wasn't very happy or motivated at that moment. I didn't know what to think. So it took me kind of a couple weeks to wrap my mind around it and get back up on the horse and start training again and start thinking about what I want to do. Then I heard Dana White announce Misha's one fight away. And I'm like, okay, shoot, it's not what I wanted. But one more fight isn't bad." And then he's like, "Oh, she's still a few more fights away. I see another headline come out. I'm like, what's going on here? Like, realistically, you seem to be reneging on the entire thing. I don't know what's going on. One fight, two fights, how many fights, if ever?" I understand what she's feeling. You know, it does seem like she's been in that spot where she's about to get bumped up. Misha later saying, I'm not going to read the entire thing, but saying that she's willing to retire unless the UFC can, quote, make some serious changes. She tweeted and then deleted a figure recently from when she fought on UFC on Fox. Apparently, Misha made less than $150,000, which, considering the level star she is, that is a terrible amount of money. Misha probably deserves making between $300,000 and $500,000. Paying her barely six figures for a fight is pretty ridiculous. So she seems pissed off, and I think it was the UFC's UFC channel. Or the UFC's UFC channel, the UFC's YouTube channel, and they posted like, oh, the fights in November are powered by Misha Tate, and it was like a clip of her slamming a chick, and it's like, oh, wow, this is such a cheap way to try and make good with her. I think the UFC knows how much of a asset she really is, and will probably start paying her more money, and will probably give her the next fight against Ronda, unless it ends up being Cyborg. They'll take her a little more seriously than they have, because threatening a retirement is big. It's funny how this is just another story to put in a giant pile of stories that are this trend of the UFC mistreating a fighter or mistreating fighters. Probably the biggest story of the year being the Reebok deal and how fighters got fucked over. You know, and we see stories about, yeah, the fighters probably get 20% of the piece of pie, where in every other sport, the athletes make about half or a little less than half, not 20%. I used to never think it and think that there wasn't a chance the UFC was going to lose its grip on the sport, because since I've been alive, sports have been incredibly monopolized by different businesses. The NFL has a stranglehold on football. The MLB, the NBA, the NHL, all these sports leagues are synonymous with that sport, and they are unquestionably the top league. And I thought the UFC, you know, I was not a fan of the sport when Pride was still big, but the UFC has sort of turned into the sport, or the biggest name in the sport, but I'm starting to think more and more that they might lose their grip. Do you think there's a chance that, you know, with all these stories more and more about how they're sort of abusing, not directly abusing fighters, but taking advantage of the leverage that they have, I think this might lead to them losing that stranglehold. We had a caller, and I was talking during the call, so I wasn't able to get it. So if you were just calling, call back in, and hopefully when you call back in, you won't be ranting. But really quick, Pat, what do you think about this disturbing trend going on in the sport?
Well, obviously, we've talked about it more and more over the past weeks and months as the UFC has been dealing with a lot of different issues. And this whole Misha Tate development, I really have mixed feelings on it because, first of all, if you're on the UFC on Fox card, you should definitely be making some good money. But for me, I think, I don't know, should she be making more than $125,000? Probably. She's on the main card. I'm not sure which particular event we were talking about, but certainly slotted high on the main card on UFC on Fox. And 125, though, that is a lot more than most people make in the UFC. That is a huge chunk more than most people make. And really, all Misha Tate is famous for is losing to Ronda Rousey and wrestle humping chicks. Like, she does not have a super engaging style. She is not Ronda Rousey. She doesn't come out there and finish people, well, hardly ever, and or do it in a quick, emphatic fashion. She is a wrestler. She is the women's John Fitch. She just comes out and she'll wet blanket you. She has been developing a little bit of striking lately, but it's one of those things. She is the wrestler. She could hope to be Josh Koscheck someday. But right now, she's just not quite there. She's at that John Fitch stage, in my opinion. Just serviceable enough striking to get her inside the distance and create a decent shot. And so that's why she gets paid the way she does. She doesn't have consistent performances. She also lost to Kat Zingano. She's been cracked super hard by pretty much every chick she's fought lately. And she's got a win and lose record. She hasn't built up any super solid, consistent streak. And, you know, for her to get mad and pout and threaten to retire because she doesn't get to fight Ronda Rousey for the third fucking time, you've already been armbarred by her twice. She was never close at any point in any of those fights. And she doesn't understand why the undefeated women's boxing champion, one of the greatest women boxers of our time, she doesn't understand why she's getting leapfrogged when she's actually been able to put together at least a 2-fight winning streak.
I agree with Tate. You can't say, oh, you get a MMA title shot because you were good at a different sport. She beat Rocky Pennington by split decision and Marion Renault. Like, come on, son. Ronda Rousey literally, like, Tate is on such a more impressive streak. Real quick, too, that John Cena clip you heard wasn't me. Our caller called back, and usually when I answer a call and someone's talking, they know to not talk before that person's done talking, but this person was trolling us. Chris White 209 playing that John Cena drop, you son of a bitch. If you're listening, whatever you do, if you have a Twitter, don't follow Chris White 209 on Twitter. Tate, her win streak right now against Jessica Eye, Sarah McMahon, Rin Nakai, and Liz Carmouche is 1,000,000 times more impressive than beating Rocky Pennington by split decision and Marion Renault by decision. Come on, son.
I mean, come on, son. That is not debatable. But the thing of this is that Ronda Rousey, again, she's already beat Misha Tate twice. So what are you going to do? Are you just going to have Ronda Rousey keep fighting Misha Tate every 3 to 6 months? Are they just going to keep, you know, making Ronda Rousey fight Misha Tate whenever there's not a new fresh contender? Because that's really what this is. I mean, as it stands right now,
you're saying 3 to 6 months, but it's been 2 years.
No, well, and that's the thing. That's because they've been saying, okay, we're not going to do this every 3 to 6 months thing. Yeah, you need to put on a streak. And she has done that. She's put on her little streak. She's got her four fights now. But she will lose to Ronda Rousey again. I'm sorry. You should never say never. And don't count your chickens before they hatch. We can just talk a million cliches. I really don't think she'll ever beat Ronda Rousey. And that's just my opinion of it. And the
I
UFC,
don't either, but I think if, she deserves it.
She deserves it. That she does. But you know what? Ronda Rousey deserves to fight somebody else. This isn't about, you know, deserving here. Holly Holm, I mean, hey, she's got her two-fight winning streak. Yeah, granted, it's not against any noteworthy competition, really. And Misha Tate, she would probably derail Holly Holm, if we're being honest. That's really what a lot of this is. And you, at a certain point, though, some fish need to get through the proverbial net. If you dig what I'm saying here, Jake, you know, you can't have the gatekeeper beating all the competition, and so nobody ever gets to fight the champion. You know, that's just what this has to be, because Misha Tate, she's probably actually, she lost to Kat Zingano. She got TKO'd, so that's, you would have to say she's at least in the top three in the women's 135-pound division. But there has to be some new blood at some point. Kat Zingano and Misha Tate can't keep beating all the potential prospects so that Ronda Rousey never gets to fight anybody new. She's got to be able to fight somebody else, and this is just an opportunity. She technically has a win streak, and yeah, the fact that she's a champion in another sport doesn't automatically make her deserving. Look at Sarah McMahon and look at how things have played out for her. But again, I just think you have to do it at some point. You need to create enough interest for that rematch to happen. And then, hey, you know what? Maybe by the time they do make Misha Tate, Ronda Rousey 3, people will be interested enough to watch. I personally won't be, because what if Misha Tate wins? What the fuck if Misha Tate wins? Then you're going to have Ronda Rousey come back? Then what are they going to do, best 3 out of 5? Like, that's just ridiculous. But, I mean, hey, I guess if that's the way division plays out, that's the way it plays out.
Yeah, and we shall see. Our friend Chris White 209 tweets us, saying the only competition Ronda Rousey has is Steph McMahon at WrestleMania 32. End of story. And he might be right. I mean, I really don't see anyone, Cyborg, Tate, being much of a threat for. If you want to talk about not deserving it, Bitch Kohei getting that title shot was just the biggest joke of all time, people. Let's move on. Tim Kennedy posting something pretty interesting. He's been outspoken about the Reebok deal. We assume he's still in the UFC. He hasn't fought for a while. Has not fought in 2015 since losing to Yoel Romero of September 2014. Doesn't have a fight lined up, I don't think, and hasn't had a fight scheduled since. He tweets a picture of him looking all sorts of Jack Diesel, saying, quote, 220 pounds feels way better than 185. Fedor is in trouble come New Year's Eve. Hashtag bulking. Hashtag winter coat. Is Tim trolling us, or do you think there's a legitimate chance that in the next couple months, in the next month, I guess it would need to be, if it'll be by New Year's, do you think that there is any chance we see Kennedy leave the UFC and fight Fedor? I mean, that would be a super fun fight. I think Fedor, just because I would be really compelled to see physically how they matched up, because Kennedy does not look, I mean, he's what, 5'11"? He said he was weighing 220. I think Fedor, around the same size, isn't he like 5'11 or 6'6 flat?
Yeah, 6 even, maybe 6'1.
Yeah, 6 feet. I think he weighed in like 235, his most recent fight, so man, that might size-wise be a closer fight than a lot of us think. You know, when you have a heavyweight fighting a middleweight, that would be a fight I would be very interested in watching if that promotion, I forget what it's called, that Fedor's fighting on New Year's. It sounds like the fight against Jaideep Singh got scrapped, and we're not sure who it's going to be. What are your thoughts on this Kennedy-Fedor potential fight coming up?
I think that would be career suicide for Fedor if he were to fight Tim Kennedy. That is just a no-win situation. That, I mean, if Fedor were to lose, he just got beat by a UFC middleweight. And not even like the UFC middleweight champion, like a top five, top 10 UFC middleweight. And if Fedor were to win, he just beat a UFC middleweight. He's a heavyweight. He's a heavyweight greatest of all time. What's he doing fighting a UFC middleweight? That would be a no-win prospect for Fedor. I think it would certainly be an all-win prospect for Tim Kennedy. I mean, this is apparently going to be on Spike on New Year's. I mean, if I'm correct about this, I know this is...
Yeah, I think it's Sakikabara. I just looked it up. And it's right. You know, the same owner from Pride. So, you know, there's a chance, especially if they have the capital, that they could start making waves. You know, I was just talking about how we see the UFC in this trend where there's just more and more and more and more stories about them fucking fighters over. Where will the tipping point be, and when do we start to see, you know, fighters like Davis, like Kennedy, who get upset with the UFC and realize, hey, you know, I don't need to follow this bullshit Reebok deal when I can go to Bellator, World Series of Fighting, if it works out, Sakikabara, and make a lot more, because I'm not, you know, getting screwed by the people who own the fight promotion.
Yeah, that's a great point. There's certainly an opportunity for that there. And with Bellator having the Viacom parent company owning it, they've got the super deep cable pockets of Viacom. So that's an asset there. Now, they don't have, although Bellator, as you mentioned, they don't have that terrible sponsorship deal. So they could go and get their own sponsors. And they are on Spike TV, which is a widely received channel these days. So there's certainly a great opportunity for sponsorship revenue, a much greater one, I would imagine, than they have in the UFC nowadays. But they don't have the health care that the UFC has, at least not to my knowledge. I don't recall Bellator ever saying that they were rolling out a similar fighter health care plan. The trade-off for that financially, I mean, especially with the U.S. health care system, you know, that might not be the way to go. Although I don't know that anybody, well, yeah, anybody who knows the U.S. health care system knows you can get fucked over really quick. That is the number one cause of bankruptcy in this country, is medical bills. So that UFC fighter healthcare plan, I'd imagine that has to have a great deal of weight. But if Bellator were to get something like that going, get some of these disgruntled fighters who want to jump ship and go over to Bellator once they're done, I mean, Bellator could easily do it. The only thing separating them from the UFC, at least at this point, is just the fact that they don't have the names. They've got a cable network themselves, and they have the means to really usurp the UFC's talent at this point. A lot of fighters like Scott Coker, at least to the best of my knowledge, it seems like there are some people there that fondly recall their Strikeforce days and things like that. And if Spike and Scott Coker are teaming up with Sakikabara, one of the original Pride founders, that could also help bring back a lot of people and garner interest for a new promotion or partnership here. So, yeah, I certainly think that there's a possibility for that to happen. It really depends on how the UFC plays its cards over the coming months and year or two here.
Yeah, and I wish I could, you know, get a crystal ball and see what it looks like in 2017. But like I said before, I'm becoming less and less sure that the UFC is going to be able to sort of monopolize the sport like the NFL or all those other sports leagues. Moving on, Kelvin Gastelum, apparently, he's looking very fit for his next fight. B, that next fight's not going to be against Matt Brown. A few days ago, we found out that Brown had to pull out of the fight at the Tough Mexico 2 finale. Hurt his ankle, in steps Neil Magny. Still a good fight. I was saying that Kelvin might have some issues with Brown, but in the newly announced fight against Magny, I love Neil having just moved from Denver. Seems like a nice enough fella, but I think Kelvin has got this all the way. You know, Neil's very good. Neil all around. He doesn't have many holes in his game. And he's very good at a game plan. And he's very good about going up against the guy and taking advantage of holes in his, you know, the guy he's fighting's game and going up against their gas tank. Kelvin doesn't have many holes. He's a very good wrestler. He's got heavier hands than you might think. He has some underrated heavy hands. The gas tank thing is, if Kelvin loses, is going to be his biggest issue. When Neil Magny had that 7-fight win streak, yes, he finished 4 of those fights, but none of those 4 finishes were in the first round. They were 2 second round finishes, 2 third round finishes. So Neil, you know, in that 7-fight win streak, 5 of them went 3 rounds, 2 of them went 2 rounds. He's very good about dragging fighters into deep water. He has an incredible gas tank training at altitude. If he can figure out a way to wear Kelvin down and drag him into that third round where Neil might be feeling a lot better, I feel like he might be able to pull off a decision. But I think this is Kelvin's fight to lose. We saw Neil's chin tested against Hungyu Lim. Looked like Lim, especially in that first round, was cruising toward a victory. Neil was able to come back and finish the fight via TKO. I don't think he will have that benefit of being able to rally back against Kelvin. The guy hits way too hard. So I am giving the fight to Kelvin Gastelum. What about you, Pat?
Damn, I think this is a great fight. I mean, I really would have loved to see Matt Brown versus Kelvin Gastelum. But it's great to see Neil Magny stepping in real quick and taking the call like he's one to do. And it worked out for him in his fight against Eric Silva. That was another fight. If I recall correctly, he might have taken a couple lumps early on in the fight. But from my recollection, he then ended up taking the decision fairly handily. But really, the only competition that Magny has lost against, at least recently, since he went on that, what was it, a 7-fight win streak or whatever it was, the only person to derail him was Damian Maia. And Damian Maia, he's just a freak of Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and what he did against Neil Magny is what he will do against 99% of mixed martial artists and 99.9999% of the human population. He will just wrap anybody up like an anaconda. He is one of the greatest grapplers to grace the UFC and just a fantastic Brazilian jiu-jitsu artist. And Kelvin Gastelum does not have, or at least in my opinion, he doesn't have that one specific skill set, or at least, you know, in the Ronda Rousey, Damian Maia sense, they are that freak athlete that they just train that one specific martial art, or they have that one discipline where they've been doing that their entire lives. It may not be that specific skill set that gives them the advantage. It's the training and the work ethic and all that stuff. Not to say that Kelvin Gastelum doesn't have that, not by any means, and not to say that Kelvin Gastelum isn't a great athlete, but there's different tiers. And Neil Magny and Kelvin Gastelum, I would dare say that they're pretty even on that scale of athlete. And I think Neil Magny, with his height and reach, he should be able to put it on Kelvin Gastelum. I think this will be a great fight. It should be fairly even in my eyes, although Gastelum has done nothing but good things since winning the Ultimate Fighter against Uriah Hall, and he certainly has a bright future against him and would not doubt if he won either in this fight, but I think I'd probably be leaning towards Magny myself a little bit. I'm smelling the upset special in this. I could be completely wrong, and Gastelum could just come out, get the takedowns, the ground and pound, and just completely smash him, but I conversely would not be surprised if Neil Magny boxed old Kelvin Gastelum up, and the real test will be tomorrow. Let's see how that weight cut goes. That's really what I'm looking forward to. That's going to be a good indicator, at least for me, of how things are going to go. I mean, if Kelvin Gastelum isn't looking too good, you know, it could be a bad night for him. But if he comes out looking in good shape, a decent-looking 170 with some energy, it might be a rough one for Magny.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Magny taking it on relatively short notice, I think just about 2.5 weeks there. We're going to see it, I think, November 21st. Moving on, some news. It's distressing. As an MMA fan, I hope this doesn't happen, but Khabib Sani might retire. He's out of the Tony Ferguson fight December 11th. He's had two serious knee injuries, pardon me, that have kept him on the sideline since beating RDA back April 2014. He's 22-0. His last win was a win against the champ a year and a half ago. Had a couple fights scheduled, has had to back out of both of them with injuries. I'm not sure what this injury was and how long he'll be out, but he posted on Instagram saying, I want to apologize to my fans. I broke my rib, and again, I'm out of the fight. I really wanted to come back. I'm not sure if I will ever come back. Thanks to my fans and sponsors. Praise be to Allah. This is tough. This is like, you know, he's got to be super bummed, but I hope him saying he's not sure if he'll ever come back is just, you know, sort of emotions running hard. This, you know, if he were to retire, I think this is the biggest what if the sport would ever have, because you have a dude who's undefeated, dominates everyone, beats the champ, and seemingly at the peak of his career, retires. You know, he's young. I think he's, let me Google him. Yeah, he's 27, man. He was born in 88. And he's just been killing everyone. I think if he gets his hands around the belt, he doesn't lose it for a while. And we're talking about one of the most stacked weight classes in the UFC. So I really hope we see him fight soon, because I was really looking forward to his fight against Ferguson, and he might be the best lightweight in the world. I mean, he, you know, MMA math, he is. He's beat the champion, who has beat a lot of impressive guys, Pettis and Cerrone included, and I hope in 2016 we at least see him get a crack at the belt there, because it's been a rough year for our boy Khabib.
Yeah, that it truly has. I'm quite depressed by that news as well. Really hope it's nothing that serious for Khabib. I don't think they have disclosed what the injury is. I mean, if they did, I apologize. I do not recall what they
broken
said the
rib.
Injury was.
Which broken luckily rib. Is a lot less severe than like the two serious knee injuries he just came off.
Yeah, no, quite true. But the broken rib, my goodness, with the knee injuries, you can at least rehab something and kind of stay active. But with the broken rib, my goodness,
I had a cracked rib. Yeah, I had a cracked rib about 2 years ago, and it sucked because I had just moved to Denver and I was taking part in a lot of the legal green medicine. And I just couldn't do it because I would cough, and coughing with a broken rib was just, and I broke it in the most retarded style possible. You know, I had just moved to Denver and it had just snowed. And I'm a Florida boy, man. I don't know what you do when it snows. So I'm like briskly walking through this parking lot that had spots of ice. You know, most of it was asphalt, but parts just, you know, certain areas were icy. And I take a spill on the ice and fall face forward. I put my hands out, but I still fell where one of those, I don't know what it's called, but it's one of those things at the end of a parking space that, like, you mosey your nose up with.
I don't know. What is that called?
Parking. Yeah, what the fuck is that called?
A tire stopper?
Tire stopper.
Just named it.
I fell on it and it hit my ribs. Didn't injure me bad, but it must have either bruised a rib or cracked a rib. It may have been a bruise. I never went to the doctor or anything because I didn't have insurance at the time, and I just sort of I had this body wrap, and wrapping my chest in the body wrap made things a lot more comfortable. But it was a hard few weeks of, like, not being able to turn certain ways, sleeping and driving hurt and coughing hurt and talking hurt and breathing hurt. A broken rib. Luckily, it heals faster than major things like a serious knee injury or like our boy Ramses, who just got a new hip put in. But still, it's not fun times. Shout out to our boy Ramses at the Aunt Jimmy Show. By the way, we hope you're feeling good, brother.
Hope you're recouping 100% over there, Ramses. God bless you.
Cheer.
God bless the kid, Ramses. Let me get a Ramses drop there, Jake. We need a little drop there. But certainly a rough way to go for Khabib. And as you mentioned, it would definitely be a huge question mark if Nurmagomedov were never to come back to the sport. He has beaten just about everybody, although I do look upon his win over Gleison Tibau as dubious. I do think Gleison Tibau won that fight. I may be a little biased just because I predicted that Gleison Tibau would win that fight, but from my recollection, he outgrappled and outstruck him, and that's how you win a fight. And I believe that's what winning a fight actually means.
Nothing against faggots, but I'm tired of seeing all these queers in the UFC.
Fucking A, right. We got the Aunt Jimmy Show preaching that shit.
The fight and was a work, people.
Exactly. I knew Zingano versus Rousey was a work. It was just too easy. But, yeah, Khabib, for him to go out like that, I mean, again, T-Bow fight aside, he did smoke the champion. He thoroughly smoked the champion, and he is technically 22-0. I do think that there are some guys that could potentially give him a tough time. If Benson Henderson, say, were to come back down to 155, that would be a real interesting fight. But I do think there's some tough ones out there. I'm not super sold on Khabib striking as is. But, yeah, I mean, right now, especially just with Rafael Dos Anjos as the champ, and what Khabib was able to do to Rafael Dos Anjos, he out-Dos Anjos Dos Anjos. I mean, I remember RDA having that look of desperation and bum-like confusion on his face as Khabib was just grapple-fucking him into the cage there. It was a sad sight, and RDA certainly wants none of that. He's probably stoked as hell that Khabib is not coming back to take that strap from him, because I certainly don't doubt that Nurmagomedov would beat him again. But I do think that there are some people out there that would have a chance against Khabib. But yeah, I really hope that he's not out for good, because as it stands right now, his last fight was April of 2014. And if, I mean, the way it's looking right now, he will probably be out for at least 2 years before he comes back, if he ever does, which is no way you like to see such a prime athlete go like that.
Yeah, and like I said, here's going out to a quick recovery for our boy Nurmagomedov. A segment we've done a few times, we haven't done it the last few weeks. It's called Blocked.
Blocked!
All right, this week on Blocked, I sent out a little tweet. I think it was Halloween night, You have the little cookie snatchers going door to door, getting candy, going trick-or-treating. All of us, or at least I hope most of us, have had an experience going door to door, getting delicious candy. Which house would have the best candy? I did a Twitter poll. Best Halloween candy, go. Before I read the tweet I got, which made me block someone really quick, Pat, what is your favorite candy? Period. Quick draw.
Oh, dude, Jesus Christ. You can't do that to me, Jake. I'm a candy aficionado. Oh, my Jesus.
Do you go fruit or do you go chocolate? Because Skittles, but yeah, you got to go chocolate. Favorite candy. I'm going Snickers. Which way are you going?
Now, are we strictly limited to, like, convenience store / traditional Halloween lineup candies? The big name brands. Okay.
The big name brands. Snickers. You got your caramel. You got your nougat. You got your peanut. All with a chocolate candy coating. I'm talking like Dave Damaschek.
Oh, my goodness. Why are you talking like the Sheck?
Why am I talking like Sheck here? Jerk!
It's the Snickers. Oh, my goodness. I mean, that's a good one. But for me, oh, my goodness. You son of a bitch. Why would you make me choose? I'd have to go with Reese's. Solid. Speaking Simple. Of combos, I mean, it is. It's chocolate and it's peanut butter.
You just need what two.
What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? I'm going Snickers. Pat's going Reese's. I'm talking like Dave Damaschek again. So I tweet Twitter poll, best Halloween candy, go. And I get a tweet back from Sage Northcock. Sage Northcock is his Twitter handle, who responds saying, "My balls salted and dipped in caramel." Sage Northcott. You're blocked. All right, getting back to it here. Jake Ellenberger versus Tarek Saffiedine. Also, that's going to be, I think, the co-main event, or maybe just a main card fight, unless they throw another fight on it. We haven't seen Tarek Saffiedine fight in a while. It's going to be the Fox card, headlined by Ryan Bader and Tony Johnson. Anthony Johnson, but I call him Tony because, you know, he and I are on friendly terms, which, I don't know, I'll get into the whole Bader thing next, but we're also going to see, like I said, Jake Ellenberger and Tarek Saffiedine. Tarek Saffiedine's first fight since he lost to Rory McDonald over a year ago, since we saw him fight. He had that crazy win streak. He wins the Strikeforce welterweight championship, is the last champion before they go out of, business, beats Hungyu Lim, and then loses to Rory McDonald. The guy's only lost since 2009 to elite guys. He lost to Woodley. He lost to McDonald. That's it. I think he beats Ellenberger here. Ellenberger just, man, he has gotten a very tough schedule. Going back a few years, he's gotten such a rough go at it. He's 1-4 in his last five fights, but his four losses were against current top 10 welterweights: Rory McDonald, Robbie Lawler, Kelvin Gastelum, Stephen Thompson. Those are tough fights. Yeah, he beat Josh Koscheck via north-south choke, beat Jay Heron, beat Nate Marquardt. He's been somewhat of a gatekeeper. Tarek Saffiedine, I think, lies somewhere between the level of opponent of all of his losses and all of his wins. He's better than all the people Ellenberger has recently beat. Not as good as all of his losses. I still think we see a decision here. And I think it's a 29-28 going to Saffiedine.
I think that sounds like a pretty accurate assessment there, my man. Jake Ellenberger, he really does seem to be on the downward spiral of his career. As much as I hate to say it, he burst onto the scene looking like a super solid contender. I mean, not like the kind of guy you'd expect to be where he is right now at this point in his career. I mean, when he was coming up, I remember him being in there with the Rick Stories and Johnny Hendricks and the Josh Koscheck, so these guys that were just, they could wrestle, they could strike, they had heavy hands, super solid all the way around. Looked like any of these guys could beat any of the other guy at any given time. This
would be Jake's 41st fight. That's a lot of fights.
Yeah, he's been in it for, I mean, he was in the, oh my goodness, I want to say it was the, not the IFC. Was it called the IFL.
IFL.
Yeah, I'm like, that's fights, independent film
fights
channel.
Against guys like Pat Healy, Jay Heron, who else? He fought Rick Story back in 08 in Oregon at a local show, you know, fought in M1 in Japan and South Korea, fought Carlos Condit in his UFC debut. And it was a split. It was a close fight. Had an awesome line of fights. He won 6 in a row, KOing Mike Pyle, John Howard, Jake Shields. I mean, he has a lot of very impressive wins on his record.
Yeah, he certainly does, and that's, I'm surprised to see. I mean, I'm picking Saffedine, or at least I'd imagine Saffedine would probably win this fight. I just think he's got a little bit more at this stage than Jake Ellenberger does. And again, I'm surprised, you know, as you mentioned, he had that great streak, which I think was halted by a Kampman knockout loss in a fight which he had Kampman badly, badly hurt. The fight probably could have been stopped in Ellenberger's favor right there. And gosh, you know, I hate to do the what-if thing, but who knows what kind of trajectory his career could have taken from there if that fight were stopped in the first round. But Ellenberger Kampman did end up coming back and putting him out in that second round. That was just a crazy fight. But yeah, I think Saffedine just has a little bit more left in the tank right now. I think he can imply a kind of game plan, the kind of one like he used against Nate Marquardt when he was able to defeat him and become the last Strikeforce welterweight champion. And, you know, a game or a leg kick heavy game plan, work in the distance, and, you know, just trying to be a little bit quicker than Ellenberger. If Ellenberger comes out, though, and tries to use his wrestling, maybe go back to the roots a little bit there, stick with the ground and pound. He certainly has a shot, but I think Saffedine is just well-rounded enough and just, I hate to keep saying it, but just has a little bit more left right now to where I think I would pick him for a decision in this one, potentially even a KO.
Yeah, and Saffedine does have a few KOs on his record. We'll see how that works out. Bader making more waves, takes the fight against Rumble Johnson. This is the first time we've spoken since he actually took the fight, so it is confirmed now he will fight Rumble. We're not going to break that fight down because we broke down the theoretical fight last week, as it looked like that seemed to make the most sense with Jones and Cormier taking precedence for the 205 title. Bader takes the fight, says, quote, "Well, I guess I'm going to need to beat every top 5 fighter at 205. Do you think it's a legitimate gripe he has, or do you think he just needs to shut the hell up and sack up and fight? Because I'm sort of thinking, all right, Bader, you say, oh, I guess I have to fight everyone in the top 5 now. Let's look at the top 5 aside from you. There's John Jones, who you lost to. There's Rumble John, or no, there's Cormier, who you haven't beaten. There's Rumble Johnson, who you're about to fight, you haven't beaten. There's Alexander Gustafsson, who you haven't beaten. And there's Glover Teixeira, who you lost to. So, of the 5 light heavyweights that are at the top that aren't you, you haven't beaten any of them. So how about beating one of them before you start talking about how, I guess I'm going to have to beat all of them. Like, no. Like, yeah, you've beaten everyone outside the top five. You beat OSP. You beat Evans. You beat a few more bums. Awesome. Let's see how you do against Rumble Johnson.
Very well said, Jake. That is comedy. I mean, maybe when Ryan Bader fought Phil Davis, maybe Davis was in the top five. I could see that. But yeah, certainly not currently. Not current UFC fighters. He has not done anything in that realm except for lose. And granted, he was doing pretty good against Glover Teixeira until he got in that firefight and just got knocked out. But yeah, Bader, oh, don't go complaining. Because, I mean, yeah, and what if you do have to beat every top five fighter in the UFC? It's either now or when you're the champion. And, hey, look at it like this. If you beat every top five fighter on your way up, once you become champion, I mean, I think that'd have to be a pretty nice feeling, because you probably know you're going to hold on to that title for a long time because you already beat everybody. You know, everybody at that point after that is basically a rematch, or you know, you've just got that aura of invincibility, and your confidence is through the roof at that point. So I'd say, yeah, this is actually probably the best way to go, because hey, if you end up getting knocked out again by the next top five fighter that you fight, which is a very real possibility for anybody that fights Anthony Johnson, much better to do it on your way up to the title than to achieve the title and then just lose it after one or two fights. You know, nobody really regards, when you look back at, let's say, the light heavyweight title when it was Machida that had it for like a fight or two. And even that first defense was very dubious. And then he ended up getting knocked out in the second one. And then it was just a constant changing of hands with the belt. Would you want to be included in that line where, yeah, you were a champion, you can always say you were a champion, but really you never defended your belt, you got knocked the fuck out, and that's really all anybody remembers? Or you have the possibility of putting a nice little streak together, getting that momentum, keep building that confidence, and then hey, maybe be a defending champion that can actually put some decent in the history books. I don't think that's anything to bitch about.
No, and yeah, man, Bader is a monster, and I think, you know, if he were around before this new generation of fighter, if he, you know, if you take him and put him just, you know, 7-8 years back in the Chuck and Tito era, and he dominates him, but John Jones, man, I am my favorite fighter in the UFC is Daniel Cormier. But I still think this is John Jones' belt until further notice.
Well, and I hate to jump in, but it's just so funny that you had mentioned Bader dominating in the Chuck and Tito area, because Bader even got knocked the fuck out by Tito Ortiz. He was the dude that got dropped. You were like the only dude in the UFC to... I'm sure Bader wishes he could forget that fight. That's... I mean, plus, and hey, Chuck had head kicks. I never seen Bader bust out a head kick. I remember that Chuck versus Babalu. That was, oh my goodness, that was a thing of beauty. So, I don't know. I think, man, Chuck, prime Chuck, there was just something about some prime Chuck. God bless him. God bless the Iceman.
God bless the Iceman. Glory news, Glory 25. Will air live tomorrow on ESPN 3, or I guess it's the 6th now, so live today on ESPN 3 this Friday. It's going to air, I believe it will air twice, once at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific, and it will air again on ESPN 2 at 1:30 a.m. Eastern, 10:30 p.m. Pacific on Friday night. Big news for kickboxing fans, Glory 25, you know, we weren't sure if we were going to be able to watch it since Glory and Spike split up. Glory 25, it's a good card. I'm looking forward to it. I'm glad we'll be able to watch it. You know, we have Giorgio Petrosian coming back. A lot of fun fights. I want to pull that whole card up. But, man, I'm stoked it'll be on ESPN. I hope it gets good ratings. Long term, I'm just skeptical. The pay-per-view they did last year in LA did so terribly. I think they sold like maybe 50,000. Like, it was just so horrible. It was a giant failure. And apparently they haven't been getting any ratings, which is a shame. You know, you see casual fans watch MMA and they're like, oh, they're just humping. But then you don't see any interest in kickboxing. We're seeing Giorgio Petrosian take on Josh Johnsey and Robin Van Roosmalen, the doctor, defend his lightweight belt against a Thai guy with a name whose name is so complicated I'm not even going to try and pronounce it. What are you thinking about this? Do you think it's a long-term fix?
I certainly hope it is. Although when I looked and I read the article, I hope it was joking, saying something about it being aired on ESPN3 or something like that. I'm like, is ESPN3 even a thing?
Yeah.
And that it's supposed to be re-aired on ESPN2. That's not the way to do it. I mean, again, I'm not a program director or anything like that at a major cable network, although perhaps I should be. But if the ESPN, if they're scooping up exclusive rights to what is basically the NFL of kickboxing, I mean, granted, it's not full rules Muay Thai, but it's kickboxing. If they're scooping up the biggest promotion that there is, you got to put that on main ESPN. I mean, at least just for me, that's the way I view it. What are you going to put on there on a Friday night, or a Friday or a Saturday night? I don't think the ESPN has exclusive rights to pretty much anything. I mean, yeah, maybe they have a random NBA game or something like that. I'm just struggling to think of what they could air on the main ESPN besides like the 50th iteration of SportsCenter that day. Or, you know, I mean, it really all their shows. If you watch PTI, you've seen Around the Horn. Or, well, if you've watched Around the Horn, you've seen PTI. You know, they talk about the same topics on every single show. It's just the same people saying different things for the same subject, or trying to say different things for the same subject a million different times. It would be great for them to throw this on main ESPN. So I think that would definitely help create some sustainability. Putting this on the back burner, it's probably even going to have worse results than what happened on Spike. Just for my mind, I could only imagine them getting better numbers just through ESPN being in more homes and just kind of fluking into it. But as far as creating any kind of interest or anything like that, they have to push it. That would be a great thing, and having covered several events for the MMA podcast at the Glory Tournament in LA and Glory Tournament earlier this year in San Diego, it is an awesome show. It's fantastic. I mean, I always love kickboxing. I've been into kickboxing before I got into MMA, and the level of technicality in the fights that these guys put on, it's just so friggin' fun. I don't. I mean, maybe there needs to be an Ultimate Fighter version 4 Glory or something like that to humanize the kickboxers or something like that. And then just to really break into the mainstream and show people what kickboxing is really about. But man, those are some magical cards. Every Glory card is a great card. And I hope it has nothing but long-term success. But I really think they need to put it somewhere where they're at least pushing it heavily.
Yeah, you make an awesome point. You know, it seems like it might be a short-term thing. I don't know how invested ESPN really is. final bit of news before we break down Bellator and the UFC cards here. Freddie Roach talking about GSP, talking about him maybe doing a 6-week fight camp. Let's hear what Freddie had to say in this 2-minute clip on YouTube, on Fight Hub. Follow them at Fight Hub and subscribe and all that good stuff.
Changing subjects now. George, I know, was in here
Yes.
last week. Tell me what you talked to him about, and how likely is it that he's going to come back?
Well, we didn't talk at first, but we just went right to work. I came upstairs, and there was three guys in the ring, and George was by himself. I says, what the fuck?
I said, why? How does this happen?
Why isn't George doing this right now? So I actually, my back was killing me, and I was downstairs, right? And I said, when I get downstairs, I says, you know, I got to take two pain pills because my back is really, really sore, right? And then I saw George by himself in the ring. Instead of getting two pain pills, I grabbed my mitts. And I went in there and went 10 rounds with George in the mitts.
That's your, like, pain reliever right there, right?
With no rest period at all. And so we came up with a process. He's going to train for a fight. He's going to have a six-week training camp. And at the end of the 6 weeks, if he feels like he's ready to fight and he's hungry for it like he always has been, he's going to do it. He's going to fight one more time. So if he doesn't feel it and he feels like it's just not there, he's going to let it go and he's going to retire. So I think it's a really good idea. I think it's really, really smart to do that, to see where he's at in his mind. Does he really want to fight again or not? So I really look forward to this training camp.
Well, give us an update on that. Freddie, thank you so much. I know we're running on short time. Here with Freddie Roach, Marcos Villegas, here in Hollywood, of course, at the...
So some interesting news about GSP. We might know shortly whether George comes back. Follow Freddie at Freddie Roach Official on Twitter. Marcos Villegas at Hey, It's Marcos. That's on Fight Hub on YouTube. We'll breeze through this because I know your batteries getting low. Rapid fire. GSP is coming back. Who is his first opponent right now?
Oh my goodness. First opponent, Tyron Woodley.
Tyron Woodley. I'm saying Robbie Lawler right out the gate.
Give
him a title shot. Let's get to Bellator Friday. Also tune in Friday night, tonight, I guess, if you're listening to it on Friday when we are going to release this. Bellator 145, one of the biggest cards Bellator has done in a while. We're going to be doing a filthy FRB fight party. So follow me, the MMA Podcast, Brian at Front Row Brian for the links. Pardon me. And we'll be live streaming me, Brian, Tom Lawler. We might be calling other people as well, talking about the card. Let's talk about that main card. What is your battery status? Because I don't know if we have time to break down one by one. Are you about to die over there? I know you're on your last limb.
Oh, it's looking a little shaky though, but we could maybe squeeze another 10 out of it.
Let's do it really quick.
Yeah.
Let's start with Bobby Lashley and James Thompson. Man, I think Lashley is going to go into this knowing that if he keeps it boring, he wins the fight. You know, got to avoid getting clinched up with the bigger Thompson. Don't let him grind him down. I think Lashley, you know, he's taken a lot less damage in his career. And in the rematch, I'm taking Lashley via decision. How are you going here?
Man, this is an interesting fight here. I think I'd probably... I probably have to take Lashley in the rematch as well. I think a decision sounds about right. If he plays it smart, James Thompson, different Thompson. The Colossus. He's been through some wars in his day. I think Lashley just will use that athleticism, and I think he'll be able to wear him down for the decision.
Lashley a favorite on that Bellator card, minus 430. We got David Rickles, a huge underdog against Michael Chandler, minus 1300, and I think that's for good reason. Chandler has lost to a few elite guys, But, man, he has cardio for days. And, yeah, his chin's been tested, but I think it holds in. I still think it's pretty strong. I don't think David Rickles is able to finish the fight. And I have Chandler just taking him into deep water, grinding him out, winning a very one-sided unanimous decision. What about you?
Well, this is going to be an interesting fight. Also another rematch. If I recall correctly, I mean, it happened so fast from my recollection, but I want to say that Chandler
KO'd him a couple of years ago.
Oh, savagely 44 and quickly.
Seconds in. Yeah.
Yeah, that was just a massacre. I did not expect him to be able to handle Rickles that quickly back then. However, he just came out and stood in the pocket and decided to just uppercut the hell out of Rickles' chin and send him to sleep. I don't know that Chandler is going to throw that much caution to the wind in this one. And being that this one is three rounds, I think a decision very well could be an accurate assessment for this one. He does have the KO over Rickles before, so there's certainly that possibility. But I think I'll have to roll with you on this one, Jake. I think after some harder fights for Chandler, I think he may play this one a little safer, and we may see him get the decision as opposed to another finish.
Yeah, and we'll move on to the Will Brooks fight. Before we get to the Will Brooks fight, there was an interesting story that came out. Apparently at the venue, they're having Bellator 145, which it's funny, we're breaking down Bellator 145 on the MMA Podcast 145. Brooks reported this story where he's on the phone with his mom, and the Pitbull brothers, Patricio, who's fighting on the main event, he's the current featherweight champion, and Patricky, the lightweight, who, even though Brooks is also a lightweight, they've never fought. They've had back and forths on Twitter. Brooks said something along the lines of, "I'm gonna slap you the next time I see you." Sorry about that. Sound drop was just opening a thing that I thought had a quote, but it had an auto load video. How much do you hate auto load videos? Some bullshit. But yeah, terrible. Brooks on a 7-fight winning streak apparently is talking to his mom in the lobby of the hotel, and the Pitbull brothers just come up and jump him. And Brooks tweets about it, posts a picture of a bloody shirt. The Pitbull brothers say that Brooks started it, kind of like some schoolyard stuff. Apparently there is a surveillance video. Apparently neither guy, Brooks or Freire, the two champions, will be denied a chance to defend their belt. Brooks against Marcin Held and Pitbull against Daniel Strauss. But it was an interesting story. I don't really think there's much to make of it until we hear more about it. You know, now the question is, who started it? Who was in the wrong? Who provoked who? I wouldn't be shocked if we heard that maybe Brooks said something and Pitbull doubled back and then they just started brawling. You know, in a fight like this where one says the other guy is totally wrong, the other guy says the other is totally wrong, both of them were probably in the wrong a little bit. But, apparently a dust-up. I'm glad neither will be pulled from tonight's card. But what did you make of all this news coming down? Is it pro wrestling all of a sudden where you have dust-ups, you know, in the fucking backstage area? Crazy.
Well, it very well could be headed that way. That's something that I was wondering. Is this a legit situation that actually happened? Or is this some well-crafted social media hype? One of the things, I forget if it was Patricio or Patricky that had tweeted something out. Apparently, Will Brooks had tweeted something a while back saying, "Oh, next time I see one of the Pitbull brothers, I'm going to pop him in the mouth." And he responded to that tweet after the incident, either one of the Pitbull brothers saying, "Oh, yeah, here you go. This is exactly what Will Brooks said he was going to do and exactly how it happened." So there is that interesting, you know, there's that motive right there, if you will, posted on social media. So was Will Brooks the person that started it? Were the Pitbull brothers the ones that started it? Allegedly, there's a surveillance cam footage out there somewhere. Apparently, neither of them have been charged as of yet with any kind of incident, any kind of infraction or misdemeanor as a result of this alleged scuffle. If it did happen legitimately, if there's some legit bad blood and beef, I'll reserve judgment until the video comes out, because it has to come out. I'm surprised it's not viral already. And the fact that it hasn't gone viral already kind of makes me think that this is just a little bit of a hype move for Bellator, for be it for this card this weekend or for future matches, whatever the case may be. I think there is that possibility that this is just a hype. However, at the same token, it could be the fact that this video hasn't been released just because it is in the hands of law enforcement and is being reviewed at the time. How long it would take to break down a fight like that and to really suss out exactly what happened, I don't think it would take too long, certainly not a few days, maybe more like a few hours, really, of some detailed video work. But I'd really have to reserve judgment until the video comes out, if it does. Either way, be it real or be it fake, I just don't think it's good for the sport. These guys are trained athletes, and they really need to do their fighting inside the cage.
You taking Brooks over Marcin Held. I think currently the line is pretty one-sided. Brooks a minus 400 favorite.
Yeah, I'm taking Brooks. I think Brooks is a solid talent. Held, though, he's a solid talent himself. He's got some sick grappling chops, some chops. He's like the Polish Husamar Palharas with his leg locks, if you will. Although, actually, I forget if Held is Polish. I want to say that he is either Polish or Russian. Apologies to Marcin Held. But yeah, no, he's got a great game. He can he's very sneaky. He can snatch up Will Brooks into something, but I think Will Brooks has what it takes to outpoint or possibly finish Marcin Held.
And in the main event, Daniel Strauss versus Pitbull Fieri, the featherweight. This is going to be a fun fight. Strauss has three losses on his record going back like 30 fights or something. Are two different fighters he's lost to. In Pitbull, he lost to Pitbull in 2011 via decision, and earlier this year via submission late in the fight in the fourth round. And Pat Curran beat him in the fifth round with 16 seconds left. Both of those late stoppages were via rear naked choke. Strauss, I think he's got the advantage just because he's going to be the more hungry fighter, having lost to Pitbull twice. He looked good at 132, and it's the reason he's only needed to win once since losing to Pitbull to get another shot at the belt. I think Strauss wins here, man. I think he comes out roaring, and I'm actually picking Strauss getting an early KO, looking like a beast against the Brazilian here. I think this is going to be an exciting fight, no matter who wins, no matter how it's won. Both of these guys know how to entertain, and I am taking Daniel Strauss here.
Hot take Jake on the mic. Well, that's a bold prediction there. I have to roll with Patricio here. That's my dude. I've been rolling with the Pitbull brothers since 2010, 2011, since they first came onto the scene in Bellator. I really like what they've got. They've been training under the Nogueira brothers since forever, and they've got solid games themselves. And Patricio, this is a fight he's already won twice. He did get hurt in the rematch with Strauss, but he's mentioned in his training tightening up some things, working on his game, and really putting it together against Daniel Strauss. This whole dust up with Ill Will Brooks, I think that's really going to be an X factor, though, kind of similar to the Ronda Rousey Holly Holm fight. Will this be a distraction for Patricio here? Will this be the one that's his undoing and lets Daniel Strauss get this victory very well could be a factor. As you mentioned, Strauss has been looking like a beast. I mean, he is a beast. He's been owning at 145 in Bellator for some time now, and he really has a great skill set. I think he'd do well even in the UFC at 145 pounds. But I have to roll with Patricio. He's already got the two wins, one by decision, one by a fourth round submission. And he said that he's looking for the knockout in this third fight. Whether or not he'd be able to do it, I think that's a tough task against the rangier, certainly multifaceted Strauss. But I think Patricio has what it takes to best Strauss again, albeit it could be a very close fight.
And we'll see if your battery survives through the whole UFC breakdown. A lot of fun fights, but I'm going to keep it to the main event and co-main event. This is going to be Saturday night in Sao Paulo. Some fun fights. If you want to look at the whole card, Google that shit. UFC Fight Night 77, Belfort versus Henderson 3. Let's talk co-main. Glover Teixeira, Pat Cummins. I have Glover, who is a pretty sizable favorite here. The page isn't loading, but I think last time I checked, Glover was like minus 450 or something. And for good reason, you know, Cummins is a good wrestler, but Glover's last four opponents have all been good wrestlers. Bader, Jones, Davis, OSP. He beat Bader and OSP, who are both, in their own right, amazing wrestlers. Lost to Davis and Jones. The difference why he lost to Jones and Davis was because Jones and Davis used their athleticism to really wear down Glover and take him to a decision. I don't know if Cummins is as athletic and will be able to do that. And I think Glover will eventually sneak a shot in and finish the fight via TKO. What about you, Glover Cummins? Are you still with us? Have we lost UP money?
Jake, I'm still here. I'm still with you. Chucking along. Oh, my goodness. Just barely. You know, I think, like you mentioned, Glover Teixeira, he has faced some highly accredited grapplers there. And Patrick Cummins, he's certainly probably got the best credential, or he's certainly got some good credentials up there with all of Glover's last opponents, but he does have a striking deficiency, which Teixeira certainly does not. Now, if Cummins is able to navigate his way inside and able to use a similar method to one that Phil Davis was able to employ against Glover Teixeira and really just smother him and brutalize him with ground and pound, That's really his key to winning this fight, and really his key to winning any fight. That's his MO and how he gets the job done. And he looks like he's been making some improvements himself. So I think Cummins has a decent chance here, but Teixeira, I think he's got just enough of what it takes to best Cummins here. I think he'll have just enough takedown defense, and he's got some really heavy strikes. He's got some brutal punishing shots. If he can just stave off some of those takedowns in the first round and put some good damage onto Cummins, I think that'll really help him in the fight, and I think he'll be able to get the decision. But if Cummins is able to come out in that first round and really just grapple him up and make Teixeira carry his weight, I think Cummins has a good chance at victory in this one as well. But I think, just based on momentum right now, I'd probably have to ride with Glover Teixeira in this one.
Going with Glover, the other Brazilian on the main event, is also a favorite by a decent margin. Vitor Belfort, both of these guys getting toward the end of their careers. Dan is 45, Vitor Belfort 38. They last fought in 2013, where TRT Vitor head kicked just the life out of Dan. They also fought way back, I believe, back in 06, where Dan won a decision at Pride 32 in Las Vegas. Classic card. This will be the rubber match. And I am sort of torn here. I was saying I was leaning Hendo last week, and I'm sort of leaning Vitor now. I know he's not on the juice anymore. Pat, just in case your phone dies, you break it down first for us before I get to it, and then we put a bow on this thing.
Oh, man. Well, this, you know what? I've been going back and forth as well. I'm trying to think. I want to say that I had said I was leaning towards Henderson myself last week, but man, I just keep going back and forth. TRT Vitor did just massacre Dan Henderson not too long ago, just about 2 years ago. But man, I really think that Henderson probably should have retired after the second Shogun fight. His first fight with Shogun was just super epic. And in that second fight, he was getting hurt badly real early against Shogun and was just able to come back with the Hail Mary KO. That's really what it was that got him that victory over Shogun. And I thought that would have just been the perfect spot to ride off into the sunset. But man, I feel like he could pull off a similar effort here against Vitor, but at the same time, it only took one round the second time that they came out, and it seems like the TRT-less Vitor is only good for about one round, but again, that may be all he needs against Dan Henderson. Henderson, he's been rocked against Fedor, he's been rocked against everybody. That chin has held up for decades, except for just recently, and really when he got up against TRT Vitor, that was really his undoing. And whether or not he still has that same chin, if non-TRT Vitor is going to be able to touch him the way that TRT Vitor was able to, that we'll have to find out on Saturday night. But gosh, I keep going back and forth on this fight. I mean, my heart is certainly picking Dan Henderson, but in my head, I want to say that Vitor Belfort may actually be the pick to make in this fight.
Yeah, and I, you know, for parity's sake, I'll pick Dan. But in order to win, he's going to have to withstand that early fury that, whether he's on the gimmick or not, Vitor is going to bring. And this is a Dan that's slower than he's ever been, more fragile than he's ever been. And I am curious if he does get finished here. Is this the last fight in his career? Because, I mean, odds are that he could very well get finished. And whether or not we see him keep fighting, you know, he's 45. We don't see many guys fight past 45 in the UFC. So, you know, there's not a real chance that he's going to rise up and get a belt. So when do you decide to hang it up? We will see. And I believe that does it, Pat. You made it through at least long enough for a final little outro. Follow him on Twitter at SweetPappyJones. Anything else before we get out of here?
Nah, you know what? I think that wraps it up, brother man. I hate to make this version abbreviated, but good breaking down the fights with you as always. You can follow
Hour
your boy
52,
at Sweet Pappy
Jones. Not abbreviated
Jones.
At all.
Well, you can follow me at Sweet Pappy Jones, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, whatever it is. Holler at your boy. We'll be breaking down these fights. Looking forward to catching some good action with the Bellator and UFC this weekend. Always lovely doing it with you, Jake. And thank you to everybody following, calling, showing us that support. We love y'all.
Hell yeah. Shout out to our boy P Money, C Lowenstein, Ross Finkelstein, Wesleyan Eagle, AH. Shout out. I forgot to mention it, but our boy Yao the Truth is in California for the IBJJF. The International Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Federation World Championships in Long Beach, California. He flew to Cali from New York City today, and he said he would be texting me results after all his fights. So we hope that Yao does very well at the Worlds over there. Shout out to our boy hero, Shinwoo, of course. Chris White, 209. Our boy Brooks, follow him at Brooks. _B, our boy John Henry, our boy Super Callow, our boy Shit, there are just so many of you beautiful kids. The MMA enthusiast, our girl, Jen Adams. She's at Jen Adams, JM Adams 03. Davey Boy, of course. Just all of you. We love the hell out of each and every one of you. And we'll be back next week to break down the cards we previewed today. And, of course, to break down UFC 193. We'll see if there's any more fallout from that Brooks Pitbull story. And I'm sure with a UFC pay-per-view coming up, there will be a steady stream of news coming down in mixed martial arts. We love you tuning in. As always, Twitter is at the MMA Podcast. Leave us a voicemail, 213-457-3380. And until next week, we out.
Jake, tune into the MMA Podcast every Tuesday morning.
My God, yo.
Knock the wild style, always been a foul child.
Will I, sucker? I be the coming yeah. Like Noah.
The MMA Podcast, Jake is the host, and since Ramsey's been in a wheelchair, the Aunt Jimmy Show has been on a roll. I wanna say John Jones is a host, so I think that I'll pick up the phone and dial 213-457-3380. We got hot takes on the stove, you get blood on your clothes if you're sitting in the front row. I throw on my gi and then I lace the hoops. I'll have Gal lying down cause he ain't the truth, and if Allen wasn't a cop, I'd make you. And shout out to Ross Finkelstein the Jew, cause according to you, you're an MMA guru. Abu Bisbing lost his hands, Count Dooku. If you're a fancy boy, you get a 2-minute slot. Mystery wants a title shot. So listen to the MMA Podcast. Throw a high kick, but I block that. Call me Diaz, screaming George, where you at? I want the strap, but you know that I'll never tap. So listen to the MMA Podcast. Throw a high kick, but I block that. Call me Diaz, screaming George, where you at? I want the strap, and you know that I won't tap. Mystery. The MMA Podcast. Most of us just live and breathe this fighting shit. Shut up, Jake. Shut up, Jake.